I think I've lost friends among foreign ministers. Because they say, don't you respect sovereign territory? So I said, do you respect the right of the Palestinian people to their land? And they say, we're talking about Ukraine. So I say, why is Palestine different? One of the things I've been communicating on the question of the unjust cruelty practiced against Palestinian people is in 2021, when we had COVID, one journalist broke the lockdown rules and ran into a group of police who arrested him correctly for breaking the law and kept him in a cell overnight. I got 202 letters from different press organizations, individual media. Over 100 journalists in Palestine have been killed. There's silence. Silence. So I think it's important what you're doing to challenge the false reporting in the media. When we took the case to the ICJ, the Financial Mail had a column which said the Pando problem and that I don't know foreign policy. All sorts of insults were leveled against me by the very paper you've referred to, which many people thought was a radical new introduction of media. But actually, it's become a mouthpiece of certain organizations and individuals. And we know that those that support them are busy with a regime change agenda to conservative governments and anti-liberation movements in Africa. So we must continue the challenge. We have had many debates in Parliament, even today. I was in the portfolio committee answering these very questions. Iran has funded you, and I'm called the legal arm of Hamas by Prime Minister Netanyahu. We've had these debates, but the problem we have, which I think Comrade Adam spoke to so brilliantly, we don't regard each other as full human beings. Some people are human beings and others are not. For example, the injustice in Palestine is believed to have begun on October 8. It's 7 decades. 7 decades. So people know the facts, but in order to continue their racist notion, they will never admit it. I think I've lost friends among foreign ministers because they say, don't you respect sovereign territory? So I said, do you respect the right of the Palestinian people to their land? And they say, we're talking about Ukraine. So I say, why is Palestine different? We've had the debate. And we will continue to have the debates. The latest, they're asking what the lawyers are costing government. And they say, my master is Iran, and Iran is paying because I visited Iran as an envoy of the president. Of course, nobody's my master. Partial master might be Sharif, my husband, but that's, you know, that's me and him. Iran, we are friends with Iran. They're a friend of South Africa, a partner. On the matter of the trading with Israel, well, I think I must turn the question to you. When will you stop buying Israeli-made goods? I think it's important that you never make the assumption that a government can be an activist fully. It can do courageous things, as our government has done. But it cannot go the whole hog. The whole hog is done by civil society. Don't forget that. Don't forget that in the struggle against apartheid, we had pillars: international solidarity, armed struggle, mass mobilization,
and underground.
Four pillars of struggle. Are we using mass mobilization sufficiently? When I spoke at Al-Quds in Cape Town, I said to my brothers and sisters, why are you not picketing every day outside these embassies, the five main supporters of Israel? Just 10 people would stop the genocide. Like those black sesh women, do you remember? They were always on the street corner. Stop apartheid. Imagine if every day we had a rotation and 10 of us with posters were always outside these embassies. We know who's giving arms. We know who supports Israel. Why are we not out there? It's good, you know, it's very good to be revolutionary. I'm always being shouted at as a minister. I'm used to it. People shout. Ministers this, ANC that, minister. You don't know the contribution that we're trying to make. I am living and breathing Palestine at the moment. And so what we need the activism to stand up. We need mass mobilization. I'm not only speaking to you as a community that has a large proportion of the Muslim community, I'm speaking to Christian believers as well, because they have an association of the Bible with the people of Israel. And I'm explaining to them the great books and the people of the book and why there is, at the moment, a struggle by the people of Palestine. You need to persuade, to educate, to change minds. You can't force belief. People must freely understand, and it must be their hearts which appreciate that we cannot tolerate what is being done to the people of Palestine. We must turn hearts. So don't only speak among yourselves as Muslims. Go out there, engage others. Because people who are leaders are saying, Naledi Pandor is against Christians. She's a Muslim. That's why she's taking this up. She hates people of the Bible. Absolute lie. But it's the only argument they have, a falsity, to proceed with their support of impunity against a people. And I will stand up everywhere. You've seen me speak to the most powerful foreign ministers, and I've said before them, I said yesterday, we need to get aid into Palestine. I know how we can do it. All the countries which are powerful countries with big armies that are giving arms to Israel, they must send their soldiers to the Rafah border to escort the 700 trucks of aid into Gaza. That matter is on the BBC now, and they probably think I'm a mad woman, but I'll keep saying it. The lady said to me, Minister, surely you can't expect that to happen. So I said, if the world has a conscience, that's what must happen. It must be them who ensure we don't have dead skeletons on the street of Gaza because people are starving. And she said, will Israel allow it? And I said, will Israel shoot their biggest supporters? It's only them. The supporters of Israel have a big responsibility to address the needs of the people of Gaza. And that's what we should be saying more and more and more. Finally, it's not true to say that the Palestinian Authority has sold out. I think there have been a lot of faults in them. I have said in many audiences, there were many people when we were approaching a negotiations process who tried to tell us what we should negotiate and who we should negotiate with. And we told them, we as the liberation movements want to speak for ourselves. We have our own ideas. So I have said all over the world, when they ask me, should it be this group or that? I said, prize number one. Sorry. Prize number one. The people of Palestine must decide who they want to lead them. Number two, all the factions in Palestine must sit down and talk. Because when you're united, you're a power, you're a force. If you are divided into factions, you are useless. And the issues of failures, of administration, of funding management, of the public service, those must be addressed. But I cannot agree, having worked with Minister Maliki, for example, and been with him in very difficult situations, I will not accept any allegation that he's a sellout. He isn't. He isn't. Indeed, the United Nations must change. We've been arguing for UN reform for years. The UN is not representative. It's not effective. We can see this today. One of the issues I believe we must address in the reform agenda is the composition of the UN Security Council to include Africa and other parts of the developing world. Asia is not represented properly there. I also believe that given the propensity of man for evil and conflict, we must have peace enforcement capacity in the United Nations. We can't rely on a debate in the Security Council. We can't rely on the P5. They've shown that they cannot maintain peace and security. So I think the United Nations needs to move beyond peace monitoring and have a capacity for peace enforcement. If they had it, that peace enforcement capacity would be on the ground in Palestine saving lives today. But we don't have it, and I think we should. I also think that we must ensure that this matter of the veto is reversed and we have a proper democratic way of making decisions in the United Nations. But as South Africa, we've argued that the UN should move to text-based discussions on reform. The powerful countries don't want it because they enjoy amazing hegemony at the moment. But we are pushing for it in the United Nations, and we would enjoy your support in that.